Hey guys, this is Matthew with buildyourownblog.net. And in today's video, I'm going to be talking to Boris Gorelik. Boris is a data scientist working for a company called Automatic, and they actually own WordPress.com. And he is a data scientist, and what he does is he studies the over 100 million bloggers that use WordPress.com. He studies their social interactions. So I thought it would be a fascinating conversation to talk to an actual data scientist. That's somebody I have not talked to before. Boris is over in the country of Israel. And so we had a pretty good Skype connection, but there's a little bit of a slight audio echo on his end when he talks. And unfortunately, that's the case. Was not aware of that while we were taping the interview. Did the best that I could. So there's just a slight echo, but you can pretty much still make out the conversation. So I wanted to go ahead and share this conversation with you. Tell me what you think after listening to him and our discussion on social behaviors of bloggers. Give me a comment or leave your questions below on the blog or on YouTube. And here it is, my conversation with Boris Gorelik, data scientist for WordPress.com. So, Boris Gorelik, how are you today?
I'm fine.
We already had small talk beforehand, so.
Yeah.
I'm excited about this because I've never spoken with a data scientist before. And so this ought to be really interesting. First of all, why don't you share with the audience who you are and what you do?
So you already said my name is Boris Gorelik.
Yeah.
I'm currently data scientist in Automatic. Automatic is the company behind WordPress.com. And yeah, my professional career started when I was a pharmacy student. I'm a registered pharmacist.
Oh yeah, I read that.
At some point I took a course in computer drug design. And I was fascinated about the fact that you can build mathematical models and predict virtually almost anything, provided that the model is okay. So I continued to PhD in computational chemistry. Then I worked a couple of years in biotech companies as an algorithm developer and a bioinformatician, trying to solve various problems related to human cancer.
Mm.
Yeah.
That's pretty heavy stuff.
Yeah. Then I moved to cybersecurity.
Okay.
I worked at RSA. And then I moved to Automatic. And now I study human behavior in the various aspects of blogging and content creation. But also I work hard protecting our users from spam and stuff like this.
Interesting.
That's all. I think that in previous 10 years I didn't have more than one boring week, professionally speaking.
More than one bond?
Boring week.
Oh, boring week, right.
Yes. The job is so exciting.
Awesome. Great. Well, let's get into it a little bit. So you study human behavior. Now you study this, is it more on a group macro level or it's not a micro level? So can you help, how do you study human behavior?
Well, as you may imagine, WordPress.com is a home of, I think, about more than 100 million of blogs. So there is a lot of human beings involved in that, and they generate pretty nice amount of data. And the people are social beings, so they interact with one another, they create interesting stuff, they write about things that they are interested in.
Right.
So I'm, my main curiosity interest is in social interactions between people. I study this mostly on a macro level.
Okay.
At this point.
Right? So basically you're studying how bloggers are interacting with each other. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Yes. How they interact, how communities develop, what are the social factors behind blog success and things like that. And yeah, I'm pretty new to this entire field, and it is a very fascinating field. And yeah, as I said, it's super interesting.
Yeah, it really is. So let's, you know, let's talk about the typical blogger out there around the world. I saw on your blog that you did a study and you saw that a large percentage of bloggers end up quitting within, you know, a couple of months, and then most bloggers don't survive within a year. Why is that? Why do you think that happens? Do you have any insights?
Yeah, well, I think mostly because blogging is a very hard job.
Mm-hmm.
It is super hard. I tried to run a blog a couple of years ago, and I didn't make past 6 months, I think. And now my blog that you are talking about has only two posts. So yeah, blogging is super hard. And I think, and I don't have too much evidence to support this, but I think that social feedback is a crucial factor on this, because when a person starts writing a blog, assuming that this is not a test blog, I think that the person seeks some feedback, some attention.
Yeah.
And this is the I mean, a person invests some effort and time and sometimes a substantial amount of money, and they expect to get something in return.
Mm-hmm.
So this something can be either money or attention from other people. And there is a lot of research outside of the WordPress community that shows that the attention that writers receive from the audience, mm-hmm, is the major driving force.
Hmm. Interesting.
Yes. Yes, and the study that I described in my blog post showed exactly this, that the authors who receive more feedback are more likely to keep writing. So I don't know yet what is the cause of this and what is the result of this graph, right?
Yeah.
Because you can say, well, authors who write better receive better feedback.
So when you say social feedback, you're talking about like comments, social shares. Is that what you mean?
This is what I mean, but this is not what I tested in my study, because to keep the study manageable, I only tested the amount of likes a user receives or gives to others.
Okay, so likes.
Yeah, yeah. Of course, we have comments, we have shares, we have... So, and comments can be positive comments and negative comments.
Right.
But if you want to count all this huge amount of types of interactions, you have to your model will be much more complicated.
Okay.
And this is the nice part about being models, that you can isolate simplest components of some behavior and draw conclusions and hope that sometimes those conclusions will be correct.
Yeah, exactly. Well, so what were some conclusions that maybe surprised you?
Well, the most surprising part was in the second component of this analysis. I studied how giving and receiving likes affects survival, let's call it. And then I analyzed blogs with multiple authors. And I was expecting to see that blogs in which author contributions is approximately equal will survive longer compared to blogs in which there is one dominant contributor and some non-dominant contributors. Let's call them free riders.
Okay.
From average and below.
Right.
And to my surprise and excitement, I saw that the complete opposite was the truth. So it turns out that blogs with a single strong contributor are much more likely to survive longer compared to blogs in which everybody contributes approximately the same amount of content and likes.
That is fascinating because I know there's been a lot of studies done on creativity that show individuals are much more creative individually than in a committee or in a group.
Right. So I did the study in a collaboration with a postdoc researcher in New York University, Lior Zalmanson. And he told me about two competing theories about this big field of social studies. So one theory says, yes, when there is a group, there will be eventually somebody who will do nothing and the total output of the group is smaller than the total, the input of individual group members. And of course, there is a completely opposing theory that says that, like you said, no, this is what you said. But the opposing theory says that at some cases, weak group participant will strive to catch up with the group.
Yes, I did read that. Yes.
Yeah. So at least in the context of blogging, the individual contribution is much stronger driving force than group. I don't know group.
Wow. I mean, do you have any ideas, like, psychologically why that's the case, or?
No.
Okay.
No, maybe, you know what? I mean, at the end of the day, blogging is a single task. It is a task of a single person.
Right.
Even if you and me, if you write a joint blog, when I write a post, I write it by my own.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe this. Well, I don't know. I'm not a psychologist.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, what are some of the motivations why these individuals or groups, why do people blog?
That's a good question. I don't know.
You said attention and money, sometimes both together.
But I think that money is, it's just a subjective opinion, and I didn't do any research in this field. But
okay.
I think that there are certainly people who run blogs as a business.
Right.
And there are people who run blogs as a means of
exploration or
sex exploration, and then just sharing ideas and sometimes self improvement. So I don't know, but I suspect that most of the people do it for the feedback and not for the money. I mean, for the non-monetary feedback.
Mm-hmm. I do find from the feedback that I get from people through emails and such at Build Your Own Blog that a lot of people are motivated to do something good for other people. Like they have been through a traumatic experience or, you know, they have a disability and they want to share and help people, you know, to overcome what they've had to overcome. So perhaps, what's the word, social benefit or help society, you know, I think that could be a factor as well. Do you agree?
Yes. Well, look at Wikipedia and that Stack Overflow.
Right, Wikipedia is a good example.
Huge project that are driven solely by altruistic people who just contribute super high quality content.
Yeah,
the guy that started, and they see no money of this.
Right. Yeah. Exactly.
Not directly.
Right. I was just gonna say I've read about the guy that started that. I forgot his name, but it's amazing. He's made very little money from Wikipedia.
Yeah.
But yet he's dedicated to the cause.
I should remember his name.
Yeah, me too. But yeah, so he, you know, he's still, I believe, committed today to, you know.
Yes. But he's coordinator of the project. But the content is created by millions of people.
Well, that's true. Yeah, it's not just him, right?
So this is what I mean.
So,
yes, he's the coordinating, and the Wikipedia Foundation has, I don't know, a couple of dozens of employees who receive salary to keep the system working. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, it's just volunteers who create content.
Yeah, it's amazing. And it's interesting, too, because 5 years ago, people were saying, you know, oh, don't trust Wikipedia. But
yes.
Google, like, they're constantly, you know, linking to them at the top of the search engine results. So they must.
That's because they discovered that 95% of searches or so, at least there was at least one or two Wikipedia result in first five results.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's more credible, I think, today than it used to be considered, you know. It's come a long way, I think.
Yeah.
So, I'm sorry, go ahead.
So what I was about to say that I think that approximately the same motivation is the major motivation in blogging. So people mostly blog for feedback or for self-expression and not for immediate money. Even if some of them actually make money off blogging after.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, on the social factors that you studied, did you study anything beyond the likes, or was it just likes?
I studied more than that, but at this point I'm just
okay.
Comfortable to speak about likes because.
And so obviously, the more likes, the more encouraged the blogger is to continue. Is that?
More incoming likes, but not only that, the more likes an author gives to others, the more likely this author will be writing 1 year after the analysis.
Oh, that's a good point. So
yeah.
Bloggers need to be, you know, interacting and giving feedback to other bloggers as well.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. All this, if you consider... You should remember that the correlation does not imply a causation. So we don't know what comes first.
Okay.
But, yeah. But there is a correlation between the amount of likes a person gives and the likelihood of this person to keep blogging 1 year after that.
Yeah.
There's also a very good correlation between the amount of likes a person gives to the amount of likes a person receives.
Okay.
So if you want... my take of this is if you want to receive feedback, give some feedback.
Yeah, I think that's true.
Yeah. Makes sense.
Yeah. as someone that's on all, you know, most of the platforms, I agree. Especially certain platforms, like Google Plus. If you're not interacting with people on Google Plus, they're not gonna respond to your posts very much. You know, that's what I found, and I think most people have, you know, say the same thing. A lot of social media experts say that. Based on your study, okay, now, is there anything you can tell us on the different platforms like Facebook, Google Plus, Pinterest?
No, because I don't know. I mean, I have a Twitter account and it's pretty active. Yeah. I don't have account in any other social platform, so I don't know.
Okay.
And they can't comment. I know that there was a lot of study, theoretical studies in about Facebook and Twitter and LiveJournal. There was no published study about WordPress yet.
Okay. Now your study, you know, you work for WordPress.com, which is, you know, a hosted, you know, hosted by WordPress. Did you study self-hosted blogs like WordPress.org in your study?
No, because we don't have the data about self-hosted blogs. Okay. Some of them who use Jetpack.
Okay.
We may have data to analyze them, but I didn't do this either. So it's just simply WordPress.com.
Okay. So based on your data, tell us which countries are the most active in blogging. Do you know that?
No. I mean, obviously US and English speaking blogging is the most active ones. I didn't get the data right, but I think that we have a very strong Portuguese communities. Portuguese, I mean, in Brazil.
Brazil, okay.
Yeah. There is a very interesting case of international communities devoted to K-pop culture, Korean pop culture.
Oh, okay. Korean pop culture. Great.
Yes. And these communities are just so interesting. And there are K-pop sites in Israel, in Philippines, in Indonesia, in Korea, obviously.
Yeah.
And it's a very fascinating phenomenon, which I don't yet know too much about it, but I know that, yeah, it's very interesting.
I don't either. I just know, what's that guy's name? The Gangnam Style?
Yeah.
That singer? Dancer? Yeah, he's good. Okay, well, what countries have, you know, the fewest bloggers? Do you know?
No, I don't know. But I mean, I wouldn't tell, like, because I don't know. I suppose we don't have too much in North Korea.
Right, there you go.
Yeah.
They probably are the number one.
Yeah. But except for, no, I didn't test this. I don't think we don't require country as a data field from our users.
Okay.
So, yeah, even if I wanted to know this, I wouldn't know it for certain.
Okay. I believe now, is English the number one blogging language?
Yeah.
I'm just curious, like, what's the other, you know, what makes out the top five? What are the other four?
I don't know. Portuguese.
Portuguese. Okay.
Yeah.
Because of Brazil.
Because of, yeah.
Okay.
Well, no, I don't know.
Okay.
Yeah.
What are...
I know that we have a very strong Hebrew community.
Hebrew community?
Yeah, I know because I follow some Hebrew blogs, but I don't have solid data about this.
Okay. Yeah. I know you're all about solid data. Right? As a
I can just say numbers without checking them.
That's great. I mean, you're a data scientist, so
yeah.
What are the numbers of bloggers globally, at least you can tell me with WordPress.com, how many total bloggers are there?
Well, it's constantly growing. Right now we have more than 100 million of blogs.
Wow.
And yeah, and I suppose that approximately the same number of bloggers. Most of people have only one blog.
Mm-hmm. Do you know percentage wise how many people have two or more?
I think that about 95% of users have only one blog.
Okay. I was just curious.
Yeah, but it's not because we limit them or something.
Right.
Yeah, you can create any number of blogs as you want. But yeah, most of the people, most of the users just create one blog and keep maintaining it or not.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so what are the brackets, you know, how would you break down some of these, or this population of 100 million based on,
well,
you know?
This is a very interesting question. Well, I once tried to analyze what people use WordPress.com blogs for.
Mm-hmm.
So I took a sample of blogs and just manually looked at them, me and I had a person who did the project with me. And it turns out that there is a very wide range of applications, starting from obviously personal blogs, photo portfolios, community newsletters.
Hmm.
Yeah, there are quite a few community newsletters and newsletters that are managed either by small charity groups or companies, churches.
Mm-hmm.
Many people use WordPress.com blogs for static sites, so just like a visit card. So even if you don't have any time to maintain a blog, and but you want some web presence, many people use WordPress.com for this, and we are happy with them,
mm-hmm.
and they are happy with us, obviously. But yeah.
Okay. You don't get into the motivations, obviously. I think we've...
Well, motivation is something that I'm very interested in.
Oh, okay.
Studying it and understanding it, but it is a so complicated task to understand motivation.
Right.
Yeah, I don't know yet, but I really hope that if we talk in 1 year from today, I will be able to shed some more light about this.
Absolutely, yeah. I'll make a note, yeah. And we'll touch base down the road.
Yeah.
All right.
So what I know now is just feedback, but it's not too new because we all know that people love feedback. I would like to, I don't know, to get into more details.
Hey, I just want to ask you as well, kind of get off here on a little bit, personal note. So you are a, work from home person.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, I know a lot of people, a lot of the readers of Build Your Own Blog aspire to that, you know, they want to work from home. And how do you like it?
Well, I like it very much. I enjoy it so much. I have three small kids. I see them every morning, every lunch, and every evening.
Mm-hmm.
Almost. And... Yeah, I like it very much, but I know that it's not for everybody because working from home doesn't mean just sitting at home and drinking margaritas,
yeah,
right?
Right.
Yeah. It takes a lot of discipline to work when you have to work and to be with your family when you have to be with your family.
Yeah.
Because the boundaries are very much fuzzy.
Yep.
Yeah. I like it very much, and even more the... the fact that you work from home is nice by itself, but the overall attitude of the fact that you work for a company that evaluates what you do with your output and your not your just time sitting at the office is also very much inspiring.
Yeah. I could totally relate to, I think it was on your blog, I read somewhere where you were talking about that, and you were talking about how you get to, you know, you kind of avoid the chit chat and, you know, how was your weekend and, you know, people going off in long stories about their weekends. And
no, it wasn't on my blog, but yeah, I can totally sign on this.
Oh, okay.
Maybe it was in one of my Quora answers.
That's what it was. Yeah. Yes, it was on Quora. And, you know, the office politics and all that. So, yeah, I've been doing this now for almost 4 years. So it's, I enjoy it too. But you're right, it's not exactly for everybody. It takes, you know, a special self-discipline to do this. But
by the way, At least here in Automatic, if you want to work from an office, you can hire an office and the company just, the company doesn't care where you work from. So I know of people who hire an office space and work from an office just to set the boundaries or to have a better working environment, stuff like that. So the revolutionary part, I think, of how we work is not the fact that we work from home, but the fact that we work from whenever we want to work for as long as we do our job.
Yeah, exactly. That's the way I see it too. That's how I practice what I do here. So besides a data scientist, you're also an algorithm developer. And I wanted to just get into that a little bit. You know, people hear the terms algorithm all the time, Google algorithms, Facebook's got updated their algorithm. Can you share with the Build Your Own Blog audience just a quick definition of what an algorithm is?
Well, algorithm is a sequence of actions. As simple as that. So if you ask me how to prepare coffee, I can tell you, well, you go to your coffee machine, press the button, and you have a coffee. But then you suddenly realize that you didn't put the coffee cups onto the machine. So you have to be very much detailed about the steps and the actions that you are talking about. And algorithm developer is a term that is used very much deliberately by people. I, for example, didn't have any formal education in computer science. So some people would say that I cannot call myself an algorithm developer.
Really? Okay.
Because, well, I don't know. But that's what I do for a living for last 12 years. I develop algorithms. So algorithm is a sequence of actions. Developing an algorithm is developing a sequence of actions in a very precise way.
So what is doing these sequences, you know, actions? Is it a robot or what is it?
Well, you program a computer. I mean, you can program a robot, you can program a computer, which is a special case of a robot, right? And if you want to develop an algorithm that will identify, will search content for you, like Google does,
right,
you have to understand to have very strong understanding about natural language processing and mathematics and graph theory. Graph theory is the theory that explains how entities interact one with another. That's social interactions. If I suppose that Facebook does mostly the same, but with higher emphasis on graph theory. If you develop algorithms for, I don't know, self-driving car.
Yeah.
It's just, yes, another field of mathematics and robotics and stuff like that.
I just saw a video yesterday of the two guys testing the Tesla self-driving car. Yeah, pretty amazing.
Yeah. So, yes, so algorithms are all around us. When you go to your grocery shop and you just sweep your credit card and somebody tests whether this credit card isn't stolen. It's an algorithm. Right? When you just pick up your phone and call your mother, there's tens of algorithms that check that everything is okay and that select the best route for your call from you to your mother's phone.
So they're all around us. We don't even really realize it.
Of course.
Yeah. I mean, we hear about Google and Facebook, but there's a lot more to algorithms.
Every action that you do today, you trigger tens, if not hundreds, of algorithms.
So does pretty much any application have an algorithm in it?
Yeah, of course. I mean, when you say a computer program, you say algorithm.
Okay.
It just, yeah, it's another way to say it. But even more than that, you do your everyday actions trigger many algorithms that you are not aware of. Not that you don't do it in a deliberate way. I mean, when you drive your car and you go to a crossroad, there are smart cameras that just monitor the crossroad and make sure that the traffic goes and the traffic lights are controlled by computers and security cameras, of course, and your car most probably is full of computers. Yes.
Yeah, that's true. You don't even think about it. Yeah, our cars are very computerized.
Yes. So, and I think that the world is moving towards more complicated and more interacting algorithms. And let's call them computers or applications. So at some point, your self-driving car will talk to the traffic light, so that the traffic light timing is optimal to reduce the amount of traffic jams.
Okay.
Yes. So it can be a very interesting and bright future to live in, but as you may imagine, some people will try to abuse this.
Yeah. So basically, what we used to call computer programs are now called algorithms.
It's a wider definition, but
sounds cooler.
Yeah.
Hey, Boris, is it true that Al Gore invented the algorithm?
No. Actually, algorithm it comes from an Arabic term, Arabic name.
Oh, really?
Yes.
I was just messing with you there.
No. He was a Turkmen mathematician, we can call it.
Really?
He lived, I don't know, in 9th century.
Ah, okay.
But I don't, just, I didn't check the number. His name was Al-Khwarizmi.
I did not know that. I've never heard that. Wow.
So Al Gore didn't invent algebra, neither did he invent algorithms.
Yeah. Well, we won't get into Al Gore, but I thought it was kind of interesting. Al Gore rhythm, you know? So, anyway. But, the Arabic culture, they started algebra, right?
Yes. Algebra is also an Arabic name. It means adding.
Exactly. Right. That makes sense. Wow. Fascinating. So, where do you see these algorithms going in the future?
Well, I hope that we as a human race will enjoy better algorithms and you will be able to overcome the dangers of it. Because, I mean, people may do bad things with this amount of data and communications. Mm-hmm. And sometimes what you think is a good thing, I might think that it's a bad thing.
Yeah.
So we will have to find the balance between what I think is good and what I think is cool and what I think is nice to do with the data and the computer power that I have and what you think.
Right.
That's why, for example, at WordPress, we take a lot of care not to be too intrusive into human lives.
Yeah, I was just thinking that. You're talking about things like privacy and...
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, so privacy is a very, very important thing to keep in mind when you deal with humans' data.
Absolutely.
Yeah. But yeah, I think that the world will be much more computer-driven than it is now.
Hmm. So that's good to know. WordPress keeps privacy in mind. Do you have an official policy on privacy? Or?
Yeah, of course. We have an official policy. You can find it on our homepage. But not only that, I mean, it's in our minds even before the policy.
Yeah.
I think that all the people that I talk to in the company are very much privacy-oriented and privacy-respectful. And
They've got to have some major security, right, on their system. Yeah.
Yes.
Are you involved in that at all? Because you mentioned you have a history working in security.
No, I was involved in spam detection.
Oh, okay.
But we have a very strong security team that works.
Yeah.
They are busy keeping WordPress.com secure.
Cool. Hey, I'm just curious from your experience. Or what your knowledge base, because bloggers deal with spam. Do you have any plugins that you recommend or anything to help with that?
Yeah, well, we have Akismet.
Akismet is good.
Yes.
I use that.
That's what I know.
Okay.
But bloggers who have self-hosted WordPress.com, not WordPress installations, don't deal with content spam, only with comment spam.
Okay.
And Akismet does a very good job in this. But when you host a platform for 100 million of blogs, you have to assume that some of them will try to abuse our platform for spam.
Okay. Exactly. Yeah.
So this is a unique challenge that we have that most people don't have to think about.
Mm-hmm.
Just we take care of this.
Right. Absolutely. So Boris, you said you had something you wanted to ask me about something I wrote on my blog.
No. I just. You said in your one of your posts that you highly don't recommend hosting a blog on platforms such as WordPress.com because people can hijack your account or you don't have freedom.
Right.
So, yeah, about this, it's very hard to hijack your account and you have a very strong team that does just that, prevent your account from being hijacked.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, and I think, I mean, I had at some point a very small blog. It was self-hosted. And it got 6 views per day.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But at some point, somebody shared the link and it got several thousands of views and just collapsed.
Hmm.
It won't happen on a large platform.
Okay.
So, yes, you have some freedoms that you don't have on self-hosted solutions, such as any plugin that you want, you can install and you are good.
Right.
But this freedom comes with a price.
Yeah. So, okay. Right. So I think it was in your blog you said that WordPress.com is actually the largest social media, or one of the largest social media platforms.
No, I don't think it's the largest one.
No, not the largest, but one of the largest. So
it is very large.
Yeah.
It is very large. Most people don't see it as a social network, because most people come to WordPress in general and WordPress.com just to self-express.
Right.
And many people write blog on WordPress.com and interact on Twitter or Facebook.
Right.
Which is okay. But there is a lot of social interactions in WordPress.com. Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. So you're saying that that initial, or that social aspect to WordPress.com helps bloggers because they get more feedback, more interaction.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Yes, because people don't write in a void. They write to somebody and they expect to receive some feedback most of the time. Yeah.
No, I mean, when it comes to free platforms, I'm a, you know, a fan of WordPress.com, but you know, I do advocate for self-hosted blogs, and
yes. I mean, it's a balance between your needs and your expectations.
Yeah.
Yes.
Right.
And that's the nice thing about WordPress as a open source solution.
Right.
You can have it self-hosted on your own computer. You can go to a commercial company that will do some of the job for you. You can go to us and we will do most of the job for you. And you just select what's best for you.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Absolutely.
And the program is open source, which is also fascinating. How... Yeah, I mean, open source is another...
Yeah, that is another whole topic, right?
Yes.
Do you see, I mean, just real quick, since you mentioned that, do you see open source, is the future bright for open source?
Yes, of course. I mean, major contributors to open source are commercial companies, Automatic, with WordPress, Facebook, Google, Microsoft, these huge companies, they contribute a lot to open source,
right.
Open source projects. EMC, the company I work for, also creates quite a few open source contributions, right? So it's the new model.
It's the new model, and it's still got a long ways to go. Good.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Boris Gorelik, it's been a pleasure talking with you today. I know that you have some YouTube videos and you have a blog. Where can people connect with you?
Well, I think that email is the best way to connect with me. Just boris@gorelik.net.
Okay.
And if you go to gorelik.net, you will see all the links that I think are somewhat related to me.
Okay, awesome. I will put your email address at the bottom of the show notes
yes.
here. And it's been great talking with you. My first time talking with a data scientist. And let's make a mental note to touch base again in a year. And we'll see where things are at then.
Okay.
Great.
See you in the year.
All right. Thanks for talking.
Have a nice day.
You too, Boris.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.